Wow, I have music. That's great. Thanks. It's really wonderful to be here and to be speaking to the AdExchanger Industry Preview. I know this may surprise you. I know you think that the FTC is pretty nerdy and wonky, but my agency, the Federal Trade Commission, has actually become on fleek. Our work involving advertising and tech and our issues have become fodder for some of the hottest comedy shows around. Some of you may remember the very first episode of John Oliver's Last Week Tonight included a segment on what was what he termed dubious food advertising, starring Palm Wonderful, which we believed was a pomegranate juice that promised to reduce the risk of heart disease, prostate cancer, and erectile dysfunction, and it didn't have the substantiation to back that up. David Letterman was inspired to create one of his top 10 lists of the products that the FTC had rejected after he heard news about our $1.5 million settlement with two companies that had marketed as a weight loss product, get this, caffeine-infused undergarments. Now, Matt Stone and Trey Parker weren't going to be left out. They've gotten into this act with a couple of recent episodes of South Park that I believe took the ad blocking wars to new heights. Some of you may have seen this, or these couple of episodes. They featured a world in the not too distant future where mankind struggles to block advertisements, leading ads to become stronger and to disguise themselves as news in order to survive. The hero of this story possesses a superhuman ability to distinguish ads from the news. Eventually, he links up with a girl that he discovers is not fully human, but actually sponsored content from State Farm Insurance. Now, I'm not aware that the ad industry has in fact approached the artificial intelligence singularity, at least not yet. But it is clear that advertising has become one of the most technologically advanced and data-driven industries in our economy. More than ever, advertisers leverage data to reach customers, to personalize experiences, and to predict consumer behavior. Targeted advertising can be good for your business, it can be good for business in general, and it can even be good for consumers. But these advertisements raise significant concerns about consumer privacy and autonomy. While these are definitely 21st century conundrums, the principles that my agency, the Federal Trade Commission, employs to protect consumer privacy and choice date back over 100 years to concerns that were first raised by Louis Brandeis. The FTC has long believed that consumers must be given reasonable notice and choice over how their personal data is collected and used. And that applies regardless of how many zettabytes of data we're talking about. A newly emerging form of tracking uses sensors to track customers' mobile phone signals to detect individualized or aggregate traffic patterns about consumers as they travel through stores and malls. This is known as retail mobile location tracking. The amount of data collected and the uses for the data can vary, and so do the privacy challenges that the practices raise. For instance, a retail mobile location tracking service might not track data that is unique to a device or user, or it might immediately aggregate the data collected without linking it to the user or to her device. Retailers that use this sort of aggregated information, they often use it to improve their offerings and their store layouts. Other retail mobile location trackers collect device-level data to serve consumers with ads on their smartphones that might be relevant to them as they're walking around a store or a mall. And these are very different, obviously, the aggregated versus the personalized and the direct collection and individualized. At a bare minimum, it's critical that consumers are given relevant information about retail mobile location tracking when it is happening, and that they are able to exercise some control over its use. Without better communication to consumers, we may see a demand for apps that automatically disable transmission of signals upon contact with tracking networks. More on that in a minute. But it's really not enough that companies communicate with and provide choices to consumers regarding retail mobile location tracking. They must be truthful about the choices that they're providing. And that is where one particular retail mobile location tracker got into a little bit of trouble. The name of the company was Nomi Technologies, and in our view, the concerns we had were as follows. They had a privacy policy that stated that the company would allow consumers to opt out of Nomi's service on its website and at any retail store that was using Nomi's technology. So what was the problem? For the first 9 months of 2013, the promised in-store opt-out mechanism was not available, and consumers were not informed when tracking was taking place. During this period of time, during just these 9 months, Nomi collected information about 9 million mobile devices. Now, Nomi did settle charges with us it had violated the FTC Act by misrepresenting the choices that would be offered to consumers and the information that would be made available about retail location tracking. But let me move more broadly to tracking consumers more generally. The issues surrounding tracking consumers are magnified when we consider further advances in technology. Recent studies from Berkeley and Princeton reveal that web tracking is getting more and more complicated and sophisticated. You've spent a day and a half already talking about just that. More companies are placing tracking cookies than ever before. And it's not just cookies, which at least consumers can attempt to control. Companies are increasingly using other methods, such as various device fingerprinting techniques and HTML5 local storage, to track consumers in ways that are harder to detect and make it harder for consumers to exercise control. Companies are also creating integrated marketing profiles that track consumers across multiple devices, often supplementing these profiles with information from third-party offline sources. 2 months ago, the FTC hosted a workshop to examine privacy issues raised by cross-device tracking. We wanted to hear from industry, consumer advocates, and others about the technical aspects of these emerging technologies, as well as the benefits and risks to consumers associated with their use. As consumers interact across smartphones, tablets, connected TVs, and even wearables, we face critical questions, and all of us have the responsibility to figure out how to make tracking more transparent and give consumers greater control. It's not clear that consumers are meaningfully informed about the cross-device tracking that's happening even today. We reviewed the 20 top websites in 5 popular consumer categories to see whether consumers were being tracked across their devices, and if so, how the practice was described to them. Now, we're still analyzing the data from the survey, and I expect that we'll be publishing a blog to get into more of the details. But suffice it to say for now that we detected the presence of many third parties that were engaging in cross-device tracking on these sites, and yet we didn't see very many disclosures about the practice in privacy policies or elsewhere. Now, it's troubling that consumers are not provided with information and control over these often invisible practices. The ad tech industry, you, should be mindful that the Federal Trade Commission has pushed for more consumer control over third-party data collection online for at least 15 years. In 2010, we called for the establishment of a universal Do Not Track tool where consumers could opt out of cross-site data collection in their browsers. In 2012, at an event at the White House, major trade associations committed to finding a way to honor browser-based opt-outs by the end of that year. And the World Wide Web Consortium, otherwise known as W3C, standardized the meaning and operation of the Do Not Track mechanism last August. And yet, here we are, 2016, and consumers still do not have an adequate means to opt out of data collection. Now, this is even true for advertising targeted to sensitive health conditions, which has long been a particular concern of mine. Some industry codes, as you all undoubtedly know, may rule out the use of doctor diagnoses for targeting, but visiting medical websites and other web searches involving health issues seem to be fair game. So the fact that you surfed the web or used an app to learn about an STD or a diabetes or a heart disease or whatever can be added to behavioral profiles and lead to targeted ads on other websites. For too long, this has been, in my view, a significant gap in industry rules, and it should be closed. Now, as consumers continue to struggle to control targeted advertising and data collection in both more traditional and newer forms, their concern is only growing. In one survey, 62% of Americans said that they were more concerned about internet privacy than they were 5 years ago. Only 4% said that they were less concerned. So truthfully, it's really somewhat surprising to me that the ad tech industry hasn't been more motivated to offer consumers better tools to protect their privacy, because it has always been the case that consumers could take matters into their own hands. And that is precisely what appears to be happening. PageFair recently reported that as of June 2015, an average of 45 million Americans are using ad-blocking technologies, as were 198 million customers around the globe. And that was before Apple released iOS 9, which enabled consumers to more easily incorporate ad-blocking on their iPhones and their iPads. Immediately after that, an ad-blocking app named Peace became the number one paid app in the US App Store. After 2 days in the store and 38,000 downloads, the developer withdrew the app because he was concerned that its blocking wasn't sufficiently nuanced. But guess what? Peace's number one spot in the App Store was then replaced by Crystal, another ad blocker. Now, publishers are still deciding how to deal with ad blockers. Some, like Yahoo Mail and Washington Post, experimented with locking out users who block ads. Forbes did the same and is also testing an ad light experience for those who engage with ad blocking. Slate serves a message to ad blockers asking them to sign up for premium membership. And it also, along with Huffington Post and Bloomberg, says it is looking at improving the ad experience to entice readers to voluntarily disable their ad blockers. Now, many ad blocking programs like EFF's Privacy Badger, Disconnect Me, and Mozilla's Focus will whitelist advertisers that commit to limit data retention, that is, some form of data minimization. Ghostery, which is probably the best known transparency tool in the ad tech space, reports that its most popular feature is what they call the white list this site feature. So it's kind of surprised me that so far, few advertisers seem willing to take up the offer to limit data retention or to otherwise ensure consumers that they're treating their data, the consumer's data, properly. It's really hard for me to believe that serving an ad while limiting data retention isn't better than serving no ad at all. Fortunately, more and more industry voices are recognizing that escalating a technology war with consumers really isn't the answer. Jason Kint, president of the Publishers Trade Association Digital Content Next, said it well, I believe. He said, "No business has ever succeeded long-term without meeting consumer demands. So instead of fighting consumers, let's give them what they want: more transparency and more controls. I think industry needs to make a real value proposition to consumers for online tracking. In one recent study, 91% of people rejected the notion that hidden or invisible data collection is justified by offering free or discounted content. I can't blame them. How can consumers knowingly bargain for free content without actually knowing what they're giving up, to whom, and for what purpose? So I urge you to continue to explore the creation of innovative and usable tools to address consumers' concerns about privacy. Not to find ways to work around consumer choice, but to provide consumers with something they clearly want. To see advertising, but to see advertising that respects their privacy and that they can trust. So now let me turn to native advertising. Some marketers and publishers are pivoting to native as one of the new ways to get ads in front of consumers. Native advertising, as all of you know, is ad content that matches the design, style, and behavior of the media in which it is being disseminated. These natively formatted ads are typically inserted into the regular content that a publisher, site, or social media platform provides. Now, native advertising is not a new phenomenon, but it has become much less expensive to create and deploy in digital marketing efforts, making it more attractive to advertisers. Native ads can now be easily formatted at scale to match the layout and flavor of the editorial content that surrounds it, and they can be automated and targeted to consumers on an individualized basis. Indeed, there really is no doubt that if you wanted to, many of you, I'm sure, that are representing today's high-tech, highly innovative ad industry could create native advertising that would require superhuman powers to detect, as envisioned by South Park. So I want to spend a few minutes talking to you about the FTC's native advertising enforcement policy statement, which was released just last month. Our enforcement statement's bottom line message, if you take away nothing else, this is the one that I'd love you to take away, is that no matter the media or format, advertising messages should be easily identifiable to consumers as advertising. You might wonder why we care about this. The reason is because if consumers are unable to recognize that material is advertising, they are likely to give greater weight to the material or interact with the content in ways that they otherwise would not have interacted. And this principle that consumers must understand that the communication that they're seeing or hearing is actually an ad, this principle goes way back. One of our earlier efforts involving this idea was way back with door-to-door encyclopedia salesmen, believe it or not, that would mislead consumers to think that they had won a prize in order to get in the door. We also focus on this principle with respect to unsolicited emails with misleading header information designed to get consumers to open the message or click on a link. Paid endorsements that are not adequately identified as such have the same kind of problem. And misleading ads that are designed to look like search results have also raised similar concerns. The principles that are animating all of these cases and policy statements that we've made in the past remain equally true in the world of granular segmentation and native ads, some of which are even appearing in virtual reality. Now, our policy statement on native advertising sets forth the general considerations and the factors that we're going to use to determine whether a natively formatted ad is misleading, because it appears to consumers to be indistinguishable from news, feature articles, product reviews, entertainment, or other content. We're going to look at the entire ad to evaluate the net impression that the ad conveys to reasonable consumers. We're also going to look to whether the consumer is misled to believe that the party that any party other than the sponsoring advertiser is the source of the advertising. Moreover, consumers should be able to recognize that content is sponsored before actually interacting with the content. So we're also going to look at whether any necessary disclosures are placed in a way that's obvious and in language that is unambiguous and easy to understand. And remember, disclosures that appear only through scrollovers or click-throughs may not cure otherwise deceptive ads. Now, I know that I'm preaching to the choir here. I know that many of you agree that native advertising cannot function as a workaround that tricks consumers into reading sponsored content. Many of you are concerned about maintaining the loyalty that companies and publishers work hard to build. And so you don't want to engage in activities that erode this trust. So it's in everybody's interest to ensure that consumers understand that the source that created or influenced the advertising content. This is the type of transparency that I think is key to preserving consumer trust. You can expect the Federal Trade Commission to continue its efforts in promoting transparency and enforcing against unfair and deceptive acts and practices in the marketplace. Part of our effort is going to include ensuring that the agencies, that my agency's ability to keep up with the fast pace of technology in all of the areas that we've covered is adequate and that we can do it. And that's going to include ad tech. For the past 6 years, we have brought in-house some of the leading researchers and technologists in the country to serve as our chief technologist. Dr. Lori Craner of Carnegie Mellon University has just joined us in this role, and she's following other luminaries like Ed Felton, LaTanya Sweeney, and Ashkan Sultani, all of whom have served previously as our chief technologist. We're also beefing up our frontline staff's technological capabilities through our expanded Office of Technology Research and Innovation, where our growing stable of researchers and technologists are going to work hand in hand with our attorneys and with our economists. And you can also expect us to engage and to continue to engage with universities, with advocacy groups, with think tanks, and with other institutions on cutting-edge issues, just like we did last week when we hosted our first PrivacyCon. We brought together a wide range of stakeholders to discuss the latest research related to consumer privacy, big data analytics, tracking, and data security. So before I leave, I'd like to depart one final thought to you, but it's going to require me to float back in time a little bit. Back before the world of ad tech, the world of ad blocking, granular market segmentation through data analytics. Back before Matt Stone and Trey Parker, before John Oliver, and even before David Letterman, and that's going back a long way. Let's go all the way back to one of the greatest novels in the 20th century, F. Scott Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby. It was the tortured tale of the millionaire Jay Gatsby, his quixotic obsession for the beautiful Daisy Buchanan, all as observed by Daisy's cousin, the would-be writer and narrator, Nick Carraway. Now, spoiler alert for any of you who haven't read it or haven't seen Baz Luhrmann's wonderful remake of a few years ago. It doesn't end well for Gatsby. Nick, the narrator, who describes himself as one of the few honest people I've ever known, an interesting boast, ends his story with what many have seen as a message of the hopelessness of escaping one's history. He says, "So we beat on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past." But I would like us all to read that as more of a hopeful dispatch, certainly as it pertains to the FTC and our protection of consumers in the rapidly evolving world of advertising. The explosion of connected devices, mobile apps, more robust methods of data analysis, and technologically sophisticated native advertising have both potential benefits and also raise concerns that were probably unimaginable 5 years ago. But the principles of truth in advertising, consumers' control over their data, and privacy protection, principles behind which the FTC has long stood, can and do still apply. These principles that have served us so well in the past are perhaps the best way to ensure that we can adequately protect consumers in what will certainly continue to be a rapidly evolving future. Thank you very much.